Hey guys, today we're going to talk about the difference between density and buoyancy. We're going to talk about what it means when things float and when things sink and why they do in a scientific way. So the first thing we're going to start and talk about is density. And density really has to do with 3D shapes, okay? And so it has to do with how much steel or metal is in this 3D shape and how heavy is it. And we want to know how much space it takes up, how heavy it is, and basically it's just the amount of matter in a given volume. So it does have a formula. We'll take a look at that later. So the deal is that density is affected by the amount of particles and the heaviness of the particles in the 3D shape. And it affects whether something sinks or swims. That's just basically what it does. So we're going to take a look at three things today. We're going to take a look at this density block, which is a piece of copper in a 3D square. So there's actually particles of copper in here. Do you think that it's going to sink or float? Obviously, you know it's going to sink because the density is high. It's going to be quite heavy. So it's going to sink to the bottom of my glass and it's not going to pop up. This means that it has a high density, higher density than the next thing I'm going to put in, which is this ping pong ball. We all know that the ping pong ball is going to float. And so we're going to put that ping pong ball on and we see that its density isn't as dense as the copper was down there. The last thing I'm going to put in is this nice blue ball. And what you're going to notice is it sinks to the bottom, but it comes back up and just barely floats on the top. Now we can compare their densities. If we take a look at this, we see that the object with the highest density is the copper block. It has a higher density than the ping pong ball because the ping pong ball is less dense. It floats. Whoa, that could have been bad. So the ping pong ball is floating. It's less dense. If we compare this nice little blue ball to the brick down at the bottom, we also know that this blue ball is less dense than the very dense copper block. But if we were to talk about these two items floating here, we notice that the ping pong ball has a smaller density than the ball that's floating right there. And so we're able to compare densities and we're able to basically see which things sink or float. High density is when something's really heavy. Low density is when something's very light and it's able to float. And we can compare different objects' densities by where they sit in the fluid that we have. Density has a formula and it's represented by the formula density, or D, equals mass, which is M, over volume. So we're going to actually do some practice problems because we know how to manipulate formulas now. We'll take a look at that after. When we talk about measuring density, we usually measure things in kilograms per liter or grams per liter. We always put the mass, which is like how heavy something is, over all the fluid that's there. So per liter. All right?
Water's density is 1 gram per milliliter. Objects with a density greater than 1 will sink when placed in water. Objects with a density of less than 1 will float when placed in water. If a block has a density of 0.1, it will float because its density is less than 1. Another block with a density of 0.5 will also float because its density is less than 1. Notice that more of the block was below the waterline. Another block with a density of 0.9 is also less dense than water, so it will float. We can see that as density increases, more of the block is below the waterline. Scientists have discovered that the block's density tells exactly where the block will come to rest. If the density is 0.1, then 10% will be below the waterline. To calculate where a block will come to rest, just convert density to a percent.
Now, density usually stays the same, except there is something that affects the density, and that is the temperature. We know that temperature affects a lot of things, and as particles start to speed up, they start to expand. So we need to understand that when liquids and when things are hotter, that the density is going to change. Every substance except water has a greater density in its solid state. So like when the ping pong ball is solid, it has a better density or a bigger density than if I melted it. And same with this coffee. Everything in its solid state is a lot more dense than in its liquid state, except for water. Do you know why? When we freeze water, it floats. So if water floats on top of itself, it means that when it's frozen, it's less dense than the liquid. Kind of weird, isn't it?
Density also explains why ice floats. If you freeze water, it expands. Let's use the black dots to represent the atoms in water. When you freeze water, no new atoms are added to the water. So because of the expansion, there is more room between the atoms. Compared to the atoms in liquid water, the atoms in the ice are not as tightly packed together, causing the ice to float. So try calculating density for yourself. It's mass divided by volume.
So we need to make sure too that we understand that when we add particles, so if we were to add salt, kind of like the Dead Sea, if you've ever seen people floating on it, it's actually going to increase the density. So by adding particles into my water, I'm actually making the water stronger and able to hold more things up. That's why people float in the Dead Sea. And so when we stir this together, we're going to actually get a more denser liquid. And if I added enough salt, we would actually see these things float a little higher than they used to. And so I'll show you some pictures of people in the Dead Sea floating. And you can see the Dead Sea is full of salt. It's full of particles. The water isn't just normal water. It's majorly salty. So it changed the density. It changed it so that that fluid was able to support a lot more on top of it than if it didn't have the salt in it in the first place. So here's the things that you have to remember. Density always has to do with, density has to do with the amount of matter in a given volume. And so we need to remember that certain objects have a certain density and it affects where they can float in a medium like this. If something floats on the top, it has a low density. But if something sinks, it has a high density. So just remember that and you should be good. Check out the math and you'll be able to understand it more later.
Okay guys, I just want to go over some density calculations and how to approach them if you get them in your practice problems. So density calculations have a lot of similarities with the math that we've done before. We just want to make sure that you understand that it's just a three-letter formula, which means that you just need to manipulate it and put in the numbers where they're asked. So here's the formula right here. It's kind of interesting. I found this on the internet today, that density equals this kind of love heart formula. And that's because the M and the V kind of make a heart when you connect them. So density actually equals M, which is mass, and mass is always measured in grams or kilograms, divided by the volume. And volume is usually measured in liters or milliliters. And so all you really have to do for density calculations, if you have the mass in grams, you would put it on the top. And if you had the volume, you'd put it on the bottom. And you divide those two together to get the density. And so that's just an important piece of the calculation. So remembering from our math unit that we always use and we always write out our calculation before we do any solving, just to make sure that we understand how we're doing it. There's a few things that you need to know about density. And the first thing that we want to talk about is that the density of water, so any type of water, is equal to 1 gram divided by 1 milliliter. And so the density of water is equal to 1 gram per milliliter. This is super important. So I want you to always remember that the density of water is 1. So this means that if you do a calculation and you get an answer that's lower than 1, that means that you get a decimal, something with a 0 in front of it. 0.2 grams per milliliter, 0.5 grams per milliliter, 0.33 grams per milliliter, 0.9 grams per milliliter. Any time that you get a calculation that is lower than 1, the object is going to float. It means that it's really light. So you can think about it as if the number is a decimal, it's super light, and so it will float on top of water. If you look here in this example that you see right here, you notice that there's 3 shapes. 2 of them float, and 1 of them has sank. So we know that the density of these two materials is going to be less than one. So it's going to be a decimal with a zero in front of it, like 0.33 grams per milliliter or 0.7 grams per milliliter. These two things float. This particular diagram floats a little bit more than this guy right here. And so you'll notice that it's just a little lighter or a little less than one. 0.3 is actually smaller than 0.7. So when the density is less than one, it will float. If we go to the next slide, it says if your calculation is greater than one, so 1.33 or 1.6 or 2.7, then whatever piece of material you have will sink. And so we notice here that this one right here sank. So the density of this piece of material or this metal has to be more than one. So you notice here that the density is 1.33 grams per milliliter, and that's because it sank. So the object sinks because it's greater than one. So anything over the number one, even if it's a decimal, will sink in water. When we look at some examples for calculating density, we want to remember how we do formulas. So the first thing you do is you write the formula first. So you would write D equals M over V because that's the formula. And then the second thing you'll do is fill in what you know. I want you to take a look at this chart right here and make sure that you study it and make sure that you understand what it's saying. Density, the formula equals the mass that you have, and this line means divided by the volume. Sometimes mass is measured in grams, so you'll have it right here. And sometimes volume is measured in centimeters cubed, that's for solids, or it's measured in milliliters for liquids. Or liters, it doesn't matter. So in this particular example, it says a 35 centimeter cube block, okay, has a mass, a mass of 454 grams. What's the density? So what you do is you write the formula first, which I did right here, and then you fill in what you know. So the mass, is always measured in grams. So you'll notice right here that that's what we have, 454 grams. So that's, the mass goes on the top, so that's why I wrote this on the top. The volume is a solid this time, because you can see it's solid, is measured in centimeters cubed. So that's what I put on the bottom, 35 centimeters cubed. I divided those and I got 12.97 grams per centimeters cubed. You notice that you write the unit on the top and the unit on the bottom with a line in between them. So it looks like this, grams per centimeters cubed. You can also write density in grams per milliliters. So that's how you write the units for density, okay? Remember how to manipulate formulas. So I just wanted to give you some examples just so that you know for sure. If you had the density of 16, the volume of 5, and you didn't know the mass, the first thing you would do is write out the formula, which we did here, D equals M over V. Then what we would do is we would write out what we knew. We knew that this side was 16 because that was the density. It told us it was the D. And we knew the volume, which goes on the bottom. So that's 5. In order to get this 5 out of the bottom, we put brackets, put the 5 on the top and bammed it, and we multiplied it to the other side. So when you go 5 times 16, you get 80. Remember that we're finding out what mass is, and mass is measured in grams. So the answer is 80 grams. You need to make sure that you put the units. The very last problem that I wanted to show you was one that's probably the hardest to solve and the most unlikely to see on most worksheets. If you're given the density and mass, you're stuck with trying to figure out the volume. But if you remember from math, it's really hard to have that V on the very bottom here. So what we do is we put brackets just like we did last time, and we're always eliminating the bottom. So we stick this V in the corner to bam it out. We put it on the other side, and 7.5 times V is 7.5 V. Then we divide by 7.5 to bam them out, divide by 7.5, and our answer is 0.53 milliliters because we're looking for volume. And if you notice up here in the density was measured in milliliters, and that's how I knew to write my milliliters right here. So that's how you solve density problems if you run into them on the homework.
The last definition that we want to talk about today is the word buoyancy. Maybe you've heard that word before. It really has to do with things, again, floating on top of water. We say that things are buoyant when they're able to float up above. And so when an object is in a liquid, gravity tends to want to pull it down. So for instance, when we have this brick of copper, it wants to pull it down into the liquid because gravity means that things fall down. Buoyancy is the force of water pushing upward. That's what buoyancy is. It actually exerts enough pressure upwards so that things float. When there's a lot of buoyant pressure, it means that you can float. So maybe you've jumped into a swimming pool before and like tried to do the starfish and tried to float. Maybe you float, maybe you sink, but either way, the water is pushing up on your body to try and keep you up. And so right now, this little blue thing is floating and the buoyancy of the water is allowing it to stay up and it's going acting against gravity. Buoyancy acts against gravity because buoyancy is a force moving up and gravity is a force moving down. When the density of an object, what we just talked about, is greater than the density of the water, what do you think is going to happen? If this is heavier and has a greater density than this water, will it float or will it sink? We already know it's going to sink. So the thing is that when the density is greater than the water, it will sink. When the density of this object is a lot lighter than the object will float, like my ping pong ball that I'll go get right now. So the buoyancy on the water is actually exerting pressure upwards and force upward, causing this beautiful thing to float. That's the second time that happened. Awesome. Therefore, making my lesson crazy. But anyways, that's what buoyancy is. It's a force acting against gravity. And when we have density of objects, if they're greater, if the density of this is greater than the liquid, it's going to sink. If the density is less than the object, it will come back up and it will float.